New Song Church, how you doing? Good, good. Let's stand. Let's worship the Father this day, huh?
This is no performance. Lord, I pray it's worship. Empty words I can't afford. I'm not chasing feelings. That's not why I'm singing. You're the reason for my song. And now I only wanna sing. If I sing with everything, if I sing for you, my King. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above you, heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Thank you.
What are you walking through, church? You're walking through some tough stuff, some really, really hard stuff. It's a good time to evaluate. There's a time when I didn't even sing during worship. I would just sit there and just pray through it, you know? It's a good time to do that. So it was a good time to check in, good time to ask God how am I doing? How are things going? Good time to press into him. And if you can't find anything, then that's probably some praise should be happening then, right? Yeah. Would you do that today? Would you open yourself up? Would you let him have that? Would you give him that praise? Would you give him that hurt? Would you give him that worry? Let's sing together.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, an heir of salvation, a purchase of God. Spirit washed in his blood, perfect submission, all is at rest. Well, I in my my story, and this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And this is my story, and this is my song, I'm praising my Savior.
God, I pray that we would be that we would be people that praise you all day long, that we praise you all week long, all month long, all year long, and we look back at all life long. God, thank you for meeting us here today. Thank you for opening our hearts, for revealing yourself to us, Lord. We just want to stay committed, open people to you, Lord. We give our relationships, ourselves, this church, this community, to you, God. It's all for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, it's a beautiful day. You better take a minute and tell your neighbor about it. Say hi. Shake their hand.
Thank you. You may be seated. And now it is time for our Connect cards. So grab your Connect card. You'll find it on the back of the seat in front of you. Or if you're seated in the front row or the back row, you'll find it underneath your seat. Take that out. And if this is your first time here, we would like to ask you to fill it out in its entirety. And thank you so much for coming to worship with us today. And if you're a regular attendee, then just fill out the date and the time of the service, and also that you are a regular attendee here. On the back of the Connect card is where you put your praise requests and your praises. And I have a special one to share with you today. I had a procedure done this past week, and I'm cancer-free. Such a blessed feeling. So put that down on the back of your cards, all of your praises and your requests. And thank you for coming to worship with us today. And now we would like to offer a prayer for the offering. So bow with me if you would, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for being with us through this beautiful day. And thank you for this beautiful day, dear Heavenly Father. And now, dear Heavenly Father, we have a chance to give back to you what you have given to us so wonderfully. And thank you, dear Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And while you're filling out those Connect cards, if you need just a few extra moments, there's a black drop box at the entrance of each of the entrances here. And so take that time. And also, we have some announcements coming up, so stay tuned.
Hi, my name is Ben, and this is your news to know. We would like to thank you for your continued support of New Songs outreach efforts. Because of your generosity, we are only $500 away from having the cost of our upcoming Comedy Fire completely covered. As a church, we have always felt called to reach out to our community through events like this to show the love of Jesus and ultimately point others to a real relationship with Him. If you feel called to help financially support our outreach efforts, like the upcoming Comedy Fire on Saturday, May 13th, call the church office at 258-5683 or visit the access booth today. Get ready for Family Camp 2017. On August 17th and 19th, we'll be going to the Camp of the Cross in Garrison, North Dakota for our annual family camp. Whether you are single or have a family of 50, Family Camp is for you. You can sign up now for the early bird pricing, but you may want to hurry because rates go up on June 18th. Visit the access booth or newsongbismarck.com to sign up. We can't wait to see you at Family Camp. Are you looking to know more about New Song, see where you can fit, or hear about our mission and vision? Then join us for the New Song Welcome Class. This is a class that takes place every first Sunday of the month at noon in room 105. In this one-time class, you will learn about Foursquare, New Song, and what we believe. This is a great class if you are a new attender or you just want to know more. We hope to see you there. Our featured ministry this week is the Safety Team. Are you interested in helping maintain a safe and secure environment here at New Song? Then make sure to stop by their table next to the access booth to find serving opportunities and information about the team. And finally, if you have a smellphone, we ask that you please silence it now, but feel free to like us on Facebook. Also, be sure to check out our website, newsongbismarck.com, for a full list of upcoming events and activities. That's all for your news to know. I hope that was illuminating for you. Has that always been here?
You never know what they're going to come up with. Well, Pastor Kurt sends his greetings this morning and his prayers. He is in Fargo with Emily, who's at a dance competition, and one of the ones that he finally gets to go see, because I know he can't go see all of them. But a couple other things I'd like to bring to your attention. July 23rd, we are going to the Larks Baseball Stadium, and we're going to have church that Sunday morning. And if you're interested in tickets to the game, lunch, and I believe there's a baseball hat involved in it too, for $18 a ticket, you need to get those tickets right away. You can get more information at the access booth out in the that center out there, whatever they call that thing. Okay. There's also a sign up out there for I guess they're going to do a drawing, right? For young kids, kind of like they do at the Bobcats hockey game where the kids come out and they drop the pucks at the beginning of the game. Well, they're going to give the kids a chance to go out there and say the play ball. And so if one of your kids or somebody you know might want to be involved in that, there's a drawing for that as well, because they're going to probably have more kids that can do it. But there's information about that in the access booth. And we're continuing in our third service. Last week, Mike Erickson spoke in our third service. And it's a great opportunity for people, men and women both, who feel called to preach, feel called to teach and speak, to have an opportunity to come and do that here. In a comfortable place for them. Last week, Mike did such a great job. He's been asked to speak that sermon two more times, in Elgin and New Salem. So it's a great opportunity for us and for others in order to be part of that third service. Now today, fortunately or unfortunately, however you want to look at it, I get to do the third service today. So I'm doing them all. But that's another story. But anyway, we come to the point now here, now what? What's next? Based off of the disciples who were at that point where Jesus had gone to the cross, he had been buried, risen from the dead, and now he has ascended to seat at the right hand of God. And the disciples are going, now what? What do we do? What do we do next? Where do we go? How do we conduct our lives? Can you just imagine the questions that they were asking themselves? I mean, here they'd spent the last 3 years with Jesus, probably 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They listen to all kinds of stories. They listen to his teaching. They've saw him lay hands on people and heal them. They've prayed with him. They just lived life with him for the last 3 years. And now all of a sudden he's gone. But was he really? And so now you have this place where these disciples are going, now what? Have you ever been in one of those places? I heard a couple. I've been in that place numerous times in my life when I have got to that point when I just said, now what? Approximately 7 years ago was one of the latest ones. I'm sitting in my office. I was pastoring at Beacon Community Church with my friend Pat, who Pat and I have been friends for some close to 30 years now. And we've ministered together in three different places. Well, let me rephrase that. Two different places, three different times. And he is a great friend. And he comes into my office that morning, and he sits on a little couch that's in my office, and he's got tears rolling down his cheeks. And he said, we were at the point in the church life where we were voting on a church budget. And most of the time, church budgets, they get passed without a lot of question because they're given to us by a council of people who have looked over the numbers, who are godly men and women, or we wouldn't have put them in those places. And they have said, this is good. And so a lot of times, there's not a lot of thought. And I've never been one in my own personal life about that has really looked at my church budget, because I've always been of this thing and under the impression, and I've watched it throughout my life, that God will provide for the needs of my wife, my life, my family, my children. He always has. So I never looked much at a church budget. Pat sat down with tears in his eyes, and I knew he was just tore up inside. And he said, I just had breakfast with Ed, who was the chairman of our board. And Ed says, I realistically looked at the numbers. Where our church was in Pasco County was the hardest hit county economically in the recession in all of the state of Florida. We had people that were, I have never been in a place where people were more hungry for godly things. They were more hungry for what was spiritual than any other place I've ever been up until that point. And Ed sat with Pat and he said, we're just kidding ourselves. This budget's never going to fly. These numbers are unrealistic and we can't afford both you guys. He said, I don't know what to do. He said, Pat, you and Bill are going to have to figure it out. We can only pay one of you guys this year. And Pat sat with tears rolling down his face. And he said, you knew. Anyway, I can't do that. Needless to say, Pat is still at Beacon Community Church. I am not. That's another whole story about God's blessing and God's grace that maybe one day I'll get to share with you. But it was incredible. 10 years ago, Sunday afternoon, my brother gets a knock on the door. Our family was rocked. My 23-year-old niece was killed in a car accident. Gone in a moment's notice. 10 years later, still affects my brother and his wife. What do you do? You come to that point where you're standing at the edge of the cliff and you're going, now what? What do I do? You ever been there? I believe that Christ gave us the Lord's Supper to help us battle the now what's. Because if you do these things, when you come to that point, you will be able to battle the now what's in life. As we look at the Lord's Supper this morning, and what transpired, what took place, remember the promises that come through it, I want us to help us to see how we can battle the now what's. The what now, the what's next, the where do we go. You've heard these words that we have read many, many times. We're going to read them again later this morning. It says in verse 23, for I received from the Lord that which I pass on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this is the covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. We read those every time we have communion. We'll be reading them again. But what I want us to see is that as we battle the now what's, we have to first start by looking back. Looking back at what actually transpired. The words are very similar. In Luke chapter 22, where the Lord's Supper actually takes place with his disciples, it says Jesus was with his disciples. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "This, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it the same, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is a cup. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Jesus was with his disciples, a place that they had been many, many times. Well, this is a little different because they're participating in the Passover celebration. They're having a fellowship meal that is tied to the Passover. And Jesus is there, and he's just reclining at the table, enjoying the meal with his friends, with his disciples. Jesus then takes ordinary elements that were at every table, bread and wine, ordinary elements that may be at many of our tables in the form of bread and juice or bread and wine. They're there at the table. They were common elements that he took, and he gave them very significant value. He gave them value. He also made them symbols of what? They're symbols of his death. Now, I don't know about you, but in our society and where we are, we tend to forget about death, don't we? I don't want to look back at the point of what happened to him on the cross. Now, we have something that the disciples didn't have, because we have years and years and years between, and we've had a chance to look at it many, many times, so we understand the importance of it. The disciples didn't know the importance of what was going to take place. And so he's having them look back to that time, not look back, but he's having them wanting to look at his death when they come to this table in the early church. When you think about the fact that when Jesus died, he didn't want us to forget about it. So many times we forget about death. I think about the fact that my grandmother spent 10 years in a nursing home after having a stroke. And I know the last years were really, really tough because she couldn't communicate. So the things she wanted to say, she couldn't say. And it was tough for her at the very end when she finally passed away. I don't want to remember that part. That's not what I remember. But Jesus says, this is important. I want you to remember it. In fact, Paul says later in that chapter, or in that book, in verse chapter 15, 1 through 4, this is verse 3 and 4. He says, "For I pass on to you of first importance that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures." Paul says it's important. I want you to remember this. But I'm going, I don't want to remember that. I want to remember the fact that when I took my young son, who was very, very young, I want to remember the look on grandma's face when we sat him in his lap, sat him in her lap. I want to remember the good things. I want to remember after my other grandmother passed away, that we would go to her house in Florida, that's where she gave us the house for us to go on our honeymoon. All of the good things I want to remember. I don't want to remember what happened to them. I don't want to remember the anger, the anguish, and the pain that they went through at the very end. But Jesus is saying, I want you to remember that. It's important. But it's not just important to know how he died, because when you think about this, how did Jesus really die? What transpired? When he stood before Pilate and he was accused, falsely accused of things that he had never done, what did Jesus do? Nothing. He said nothing. Did he ever retaliate against anyone who mocked him in that time? Did he retaliate against those who spit on him? Those who whipped him, those that made fun of him? Did he retaliate against any of that? To me, the worst would have had to have been when his friends all turned their back on him. How many of you know what that feels like? The reality of it is that Jesus went willingly. He had a choice. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was praying to the Father, he said, take this cup from me. If it be your will, but not my will, but your will be done. He had a choice. He went willingly. He went humbly. Why? Because of the love he had for his disciples and the love that he has for us. He went willingly. But it's not just remembering the historical facts. It's remembering the spiritual realities that take place in this table. I couldn't find Pastor Kurt's definition But the simple definition for communion, it comes from the word koinonia, which means fellowship. We have fellowship with the Savior. We have fellowship with Christ. And when we think about that, each one of us who has a relationship with Christ, we have fellowship with Him. But this is different. Because in the fellowship that we partake of in this Lord's Supper, we're participating, we're fellowshipping in His suffering because of what He did. When we talk about the broken body and the shed blood that these elements represent, we are participating, we are fellowshipping in His suffering. That's a little bit different than just fellowshipping with Him. And we're to do this until the Lord comes again. But really what this is also gives us a picture of how to live our lives. We live in a society today, don't we, that is all about us. It's about me. It's about me, myself, and I. It's about grab all you can all you get, and sit on the lid. That's what life is about. You know, but it's true. Here's a simple one, because everything, most of what we do is about us. It's about what I want. It's about what I think I need. So some of you right now are sitting there thinking, part of you are thinking in the back of your mind, you're going, where am I going for supper? Where am I going for lunch after church? And you can think about the discussions or arguments that will happen after church just over going, where are you going to go for lunch? Instead of going, I'm going to go where my wife wants to go, even though I don't like that place very well, I'm going to go there because I can die to myself a little bit, and we'll go where my wife wants to go. But there are many times when that's not truly the case. You can ask my wife. It's I go where I want to go. Because technically we live in this world that it's all about us. And so that's just a simple comical little thing about the reality of it, is that we do think a lot about ourselves instead of thinking about the picture of this table and how we must literally die to ourselves in all these instances. And not only do we want to look backwards, we want to look forwards. Forward to what's coming. In verse 26 that Paul writes, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." He is coming back. He promised us He was coming back. And what a day that will be. Can you think about that for a minute? The scriptures talk about it. In 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13 through 18, it says, "Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who have fallen asleep, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. We believe Jesus died and rose again, so we believe that God will bring Jesus, those who have fallen asleep in Him. According to His own words," the Lord's own words, "we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord Himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left here will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever." Can you imagine that day? I can't imagine what the non-believer is going to think when the heavens part and the loud commands and the sounds come and Jesus comes and the dead rise and then we go with Him. Can you imagine what they're going to think? Whoa. But what a day that will be. We get to be with Him forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and how many ever you want to put on there. And what will we do? That song a number of years ago about I Can Only Imagine. You know, there are so many things I want to ask when I see Him. I want to ask why you take a 23-year-old on the prime of life, who, just beautiful girl, beautiful life, touched the lives of many, and you take a 23 out of prime of life. But yet, I have a mother-in-law who has Alzheimer's, who's 92 years old, barely remembers her own daughter. I can't wrap my head around that. You know, there's so many things that we want to ask, but you know what reality is? I can only imagine, because I probably won't be. I probably won't want to ask those questions at all. I'd probably be face down on the ground worshiping the Holy One, because He's just worthy of all of that and more than I could ever give Him. Or maybe I'll be with the angels singing, first time in my life that I could actually sing a note on key, and I might be doing this. I don't have a clue, but I can't wait for that day. The Apostle John, or Jesus, says this in John chapter 14. He says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God." We read this a lot of times at funeral, but it's so, the truth is so true. Truth is so true. Okay. "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." When we observe the Lord's Supper, we proclaim it until he comes again, because, folks, he is coming again. And that will be a glorious day in the life of a believer, and a glorious day of a church, because it is the blessed hope that we have in the church, that he is coming again. Jesus not only died for us, he rose for us, he ascended to heaven for us, and one day he's coming back to get us. Amen? Amen. Whoa, what a day. That's a sermon all in itself. Today, according to John in 1 John, he says, "Today, we are not all that we should be. But when we see him, we shall be like him." Amen? Not only do we look backward to what took place and look forward to the fact that he's coming again, but we need to turn and look within. Because part of communion is reflection. He says, "Do this in remembrance of me," but there's also things we need to check out in ourselves. If you look at verses 27 and 28 of Corinthians, Paul writes after, he says, "So then, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment upon themselves." Paul did not say we had to be worthy to take the elements, because if we were to be worthy to take the elements, I'd never be able to take them, and neither would you, because none of us are worthy. But he says to partake of them in a worthy manner. What that means, we need to examine ourselves. We need to ask the Father to say, "What in my life have I not confessed?" Because there's a lot to do with the fact of judging the sin and confessing the sin. Now, I know when Christ went to the cross that he forgave my sin once and for all, for now and for the future. That doesn't mean I need to still not ask for that forgiveness. And to see this, the Corinthian church, they didn't examine themselves. Because when we come to this table with unconfessed sin, broken relationships between others, other believers, we are at risk of drinking judgment upon ourselves. The Corinthians church, that's what they were all about. They were all about judging other people. "Did you see what she did? Do you see what she's wearing? Oh my, look at that. Oh yes." And there was a whole lot of that going on, and a whole lot more that we're going to talk about in just a second. But the reality of it is that we're not to be religious. We're not to be religious detectives who watch out for others and then fail to look inward, fail to look at ourselves. That's what happens when I start to get teary-eyed. But if we fail to look inside ourselves, I don't mean to pound this too hard, because this is not all about that. But we do stand risk of drinking judgment upon ourselves if we have things in our life that are not confessed or laid at his feet to ask for forgiveness. But not only do we look backwards, forwards, and look within, but we need to look around. The Corinthian church, they were bad. The Corinthian church, Paul says in verse 33 and 34, he says, "So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather to eat, you should all eat together. Anyone who is hungry should eat something at home, And when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. We need to look around. We need to look around at the people that we're with and the relationships that we have. The Corinthian church, they weren't like that. For us, we have pulled this sacrament, this communion table, and we have pulled it apart, and we had put it as a beautiful ceremony in our Sunday services across this country and around the world. When the Corinthian church, that was part of a bigger celebration. It was part of a fellowship meal. And what was transpiring is that sometimes the elderly, maybe it was the lower class, depending on the where it was, they would get pushed aside. And many others were being gluttons and pigs when others were going hungry. The other thing is that many of them were becoming drunkards and drinking way too much, and others would get left away from the table. Even the prime two elements that we talk about as the Lord's Supper. The reality of it is the relationships that they had with each other were not good. You know, maybe this has a dual meaning. We should discern his body in one loaf, but also one church. For the church is the body of Christ. This supper usually, it should demonstrate the unity that we have as a body of believers. If a non-believer comes up to the table, we believe in open communion. Other churches do not. We do. But if a non-believer comes to the table, it's a piece of bread and it's a cup of juice. But for you and I as believers, it has greater significant value and symbolism than just that. Because it points us back to the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. John said it, "Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another." We shouldn't come to the table as a believer if we have offenses with other believers. We should make those right. We should take care of those. I can recall when I was a pastor in Grant, Alabama, a big town of 600 people. It was huge. And there was a young one man came up to me, came into my office. He poured out his heart and told me what he had done, that he had sinned against. It was going to make a black mark on the church in a small community. Everybody in the town was talking about it, and it was associated with the church I pastored, and it was just going to make a big black mark. And he said, what do I do? We prayed together, and we cried together. As you can figure out, I like to cry a lot. But we prayed together, and I said, I can't give you a direct answer, but I know that if you seek the Father and what he would have you to do, he will make it right. The next Sunday, I reminded him that we were going to have the Lord's Supper coming up the next Sunday in the evening service. And so I opened the service in a different way than I usually do when I open up for communion. And I gave the congregation a chance to share. And he got straight up, came up to the microphone. He shared out loud with the congregation in a very calm manner, asking God for forgiveness. There was a sweep of forgiveness that overwhelmed that conversation, that whole congregation. You could just feel the Spirit of God come down in that place. It was just an incredible time of communion that we've ever had in that building. Because this young man wanted to get it right. Now, I don't want you to hear me wrong, okay? This is not supposed to be a time of spiritual autopsy, a time of grieving, even though confession of sin is important part of it. But we really want to look at this as a joyful celebration of what Christ did for us and the fact that he is coming again. It's supposed to be a time of thanksgiving. It's supposed to be a time of joyful celebration and for a time for us to give thanks. So my prayer this morning is in a few minutes the ushers are going to come and they're going to pass you the elements. And if you'll just hold those and reflect a little bit, then we will all participate in those together. But as we get ready to do that, my prayer is that you may receive the blessings from the Father as we have observed the Lord's Supper by taking a look for and at the Lord Jesus as we partake of the Lord's Supper together in a few moments. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for this table. Thank you for what the elements represent. Thank you for the shed blood and the broken body. Father, help us to look inside ourselves this morning so we would not be guilty as a Corinthian church, but that we can truly look with joyful celebration and anticipation of that day when you will come and we will participate in this supper together as we will be with you, as you take us to be with you. Father, thank you for that. Thank you for that. And we will give you the praise and the glory and the honor that you so rightly deserve. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Darkness in your eyes, there's no question in your mind, God Almighty, and God of mercy. There's no hiding from your face. There's no striving in your grace, God of mercy, God Almighty. Let there be of the blind, purify our hearts in your fire, and breathe in us, we pray. Jesus, have your way. There's no borders in your love, and no division in your heart, God of heaven, and God of freedom. There's no taking back the cross, no regret in what it cost, God of freedom, God of heaven. Let there be light,
That shines above, become the light that shines in us. There's no darkness in your way, so have your